Welcome friends, back for another F1 fantasy video with me, Tom, and this is the second to last race weekend of the season. We're almost there, guys. We've been plugging away for months and months and months, and we're almost there. We've got the sprint weekend in Brazil coming up, and I'm going to be in this video talking about what I'm thinking, as usual, about my team selection going into this weekend. It's you know, is there such thing as an easy team selection this season? No, I don't think it is. Maybe one or two weekends have been straightforward, but something always comes up. There's always grid penalties and performance issues and whatnot going on, and so we're gonna have a think about what's going on, you know, a few days ahead of time, because we've only got one practice session before we go straight into the deadline. And speaking of deadline, I am going to be very much planning to do a deadline live stream if people are interested in joining in the sort of the final hour leading up to the deadline. So for me in the UK, that's going to be Friday afternoon. I think the deadline's at 7 p.m. UK time. So yeah, whenever the deadline is, just tune in. I'll be here stressing out, probably pulling my hair out after just one practice session. But before going into the deadline stream, obviously I've got some ideas in mind of what I want to do. And we've got the practice session ahead of that. So the practice session is going to be, you know, the be all and end all basically of where I end up. So let's have a look at what I'm considering. I'm going to have a look at my team in a second, this is my team right now. And I'm also going to have a quick look at the spreadsheet, because there's a couple of things, very interesting things that I just want to point out, which may be useful regarding our team selection this weekend. So this is my team, as you can see on screen. This is what I had in Mexico. And I do definitely very much regret not having the confidence to just pick one of the Mercedes boys. So, you know, there's a big debate going on in my head about, do I go with Mercedes constructor? Do I go with George Russell? Do I go with Lewis Hamilton? And I was just like, I can't handle it. And in the end, I feel like I took the coward's way out and just stuck with Leclerc, because it's like, he's kind of the safe option that's been there all season. But really, the reality was, Mercedes' performance, like, was clearly there to be seen before the deadline. I should have gone with Lewis Hamilton or George Russell. And I regret it. And I've missed out on a few points, but it's not, you know, it's not the end of the world. But yeah, you know, in my head I was thinking the practice sessions are like have misled me in the past, and I got a bit caught up thinking, no, I don't trust the results from practice sessions. I should have done, particularly as George Russell and Lewis Hamilton, you know, across the Friday and going into the deadline, went in their interviews were saying quite like they were exuding confidence, and I should have kind of picked up on that and put them in my team. But I didn't, went with Leclerc, had an okay weekend, maintained my rank of, I think I'm 1.5k global, but I do expect that to drop this weekend, because I don't have the Mega Driver left available to me, and anyone who does have the Mega Driver left is probably going to stick it on Max Verstappen this weekend. So as long as Max Verstappen does well, I would anticipate myself dropping down in the ranks, at least probably a few thousand positions, which is a bit sad because I'm right on the cusp of getting into the top 1,000, but not quite there. So yeah, if Max Verstappen doesn't have a good weekend, then maybe I can get in there. And that kind of brings up an interesting thought as to how heavy do we go on Max Verstappen, because do we try and cover him as much as possible? But like, for example, I can just throw in a team here. If I bring in Max Verstappen, could have a team that looks kind of like this as an example. I mean, this is squeezing in like with my budget, and I know that my budget is more than a lot of other people. You might have to make a compromise. For example, Alonso, for example, could be cut down to someone down here, like a Haas driver or something. It all depends on the budget. But this is a team that I could personally go for just about. I mean, I'm, you know, literally zero money in the bank, but so I'm not sure how feasible it's going to be. But the point is that I'm trying to make is, how heavy do we go on Max Verstappen and Red Bull? Because they're clearly the best team this season. Verstappen's clearly in the world of his own, just like in a league of his own. Well, yeah, and a world of his own, just like winning every race. I think he's won 14 out of 20 races. I think that's the right statistic currently, which is absolutely insane. 14 out of 20 is just insane. And therefore, do we want to go all in with Max Verstappen to try and nullify to some extent what's going on with the Mega Driver? You know, doubling up on Red Bull plus Verstappen, is that the way to go about it? Or do we just kind of ignore the fact that there's going to be a bunch of people putting the Mega Driver on him? Just don't bother putting him in the team at all, and maybe go with a team more like, as an example, something I'm very strongly considering is a team that goes like this. I'm very, very confident that this team should score well. It does kind of neglect Max Verstappen, apart from the constructor. It's going to pick up a few points for that. So to some small extent, it will nullify if Max Verstappen does well. But at the same time, I do anticipate a rank drop regardless, unless Max Verstappen DNFs. If Max Verstappen DNFs and I have a team like this, I should score quite well, I would imagine. So it's all kind of depends how do you want to play it, what sort of manager are you, how much risk do you want to take, what's your goal, What are you trying to achieve? Are you trying to just achieve a good global rank, or have you got little mini leagues that you want to try and overtake? Look at who's in the team. If you're, for example, second in your mini league and you want to try and get the guy above you, and maybe the guy above you has the mega driver left available to you, maybe the only way to actually get ahead of him is to go completely against the grain and not have Max Verstappen coverage at all. Just kind of cross your fingers and hope that Max Verstappen DNFs or has a bad race for whatever reason. And therefore, you can leapfrog that opponent in your league. So it kind of completely depends. Like for me personally, my only real goal, I know it's kind of a bit sad, but my only real goal is just to get a good global rank. Just want a good global rank, so I can, right, that's what I'm here for really. And I'm currently sat at 1.5K, and so therefore, do I want to try and cover Max Verstappen to some extent and try and nullify the Mega Driver and maybe only drop back a couple of thousand? Or do I want to go completely kind of against it with a team kind of more like this, where I just kind of forget about Max Verstappen to a large extent? And if he DNFs, then I could probably, do fine out of it. So yeah, I'm at the moment I'm kind of leaning towards a team like this, and I'll tell you why I'm leaning towards a team like this. Let's have a look at the spreadsheet and I'll explain why. So Hamilton and Vettel are the two kind of interesting picks here. If we go have a look at the spreadsheet, look at this column over here, column N in the green over here. This column is very fascinating to me because it kind of tells the story of the whole season in just one simple statistic of these. This column represents the points from positions gained and lost, and I've included DNF. So this number will slightly differ from what you'll see on the F1 Fantasy website for positions gained, etc., because I've incorporated the DNF factor, which is an automatic minus 10. But what stands out for me is the Ferraris, quite clearly, minus 66, both of them, like level on points for positions gained and lost. Like they clearly qualify well. That tells me that the Ferraris qualify well, but they are not reliable. They don't quite have the race pace to back up their qualifying pace. We know all about the Ferrari strategy hasn't been great at times this season, and as a result of that, they are bottom of the league table for positions, points gained from positions. So they're minus 66 apiece. And then in contrast to that, the other end of the scale, we've got the Aston Martins. We've got Vettel and Stroll sitting around the 100 mark. Like that is a huge difference. A huge difference from minus 66 to positive 100, or to be precise, 92 and 108. And that is why you can see here Sebastian Vettel is one of my preferred budget drivers. And I just think he's in good form recently. Let's have a quick look at what he's done just to back up what I'm saying. Look at the recent scores: 13, 18, 25, 17. They're all decent. Obviously, you've got the minus 7 back there, but past that, 12, 19, 16. He's scoring very consistently well, with the exception of Italy in there. He's scoring very consistently well for a very good price. He's still only 10 million. He's in a good price, affordable price range for a lot of people. And we can see the stat there, 92 points. I think he's a very good budget option this weekend. And it tells a similar story with what's going on with Lewis Hamilton and George Russell as well. 46 points for Lewis Hamilton and 60. That again tells me perhaps not qualifying as well as they should do, but that their car is better in race conditions than it is in qualifying conditions, which is great for fantasy. As we can see, if you don't qualify particularly well, just like the Aston Martins and perhaps the Mercedes, relative to your race pace and your reliability, then you're going to gain those points in terms of fantasy. And we can see that in this little table, both Hamilton and Russell representing Mercedes as, a good consistent car, which is why, Hamilton at 46 compared to Leclerc at minus 66. And Lewis Hamilton, Brazil, he's got a great history around this track. Last season was another sprint race round into Lagos, and he got disqualified from quali. He started at the back from the sprint, worked his way towards the front, and then he ended up winning the Grand Prix as well. Like, I think Lewis Hamilton's a really safe, tidy, kind of comfortable pick that just gives you a nice warm feeling if you pick him. Whereas if I pick Leclerc, I'd be just like, oh, I don't know what's going to happen. I'm a bit nervous. And I quite like just to have a kind of a stress-free weekend, to be honest, and just pick Hamilton and kind of forget about it. I know he'll do reasonably well. Also, the whole thing about altitude, Mexico being like the high altitude over 2,000 meters above sea level, which has led to the draggy Mercedes performing particularly well. Brazil was also quite high above sea level. I think it's around 700 or 800 meters, so it's not quite the extreme of Mexico, but we should still perhaps see the Mercedes perform quite well around here. It's not quite as high a downforce track as what Mexico was in Interlagos, not quite so high downforce. So and that's clearly where Mercedes have excelled. So we won't see perhaps quite the performance that we see from the Mercedes in Mexico, but I do anticipate them to maintain more or less where they're at, and they should be competing for the podium, I think. The Ferraris were just terrible in Mexico, and to be honest, they've been pretty poor ever since the technical directive came around Spa Grand Prix. They've just been on a kind of a downward trajectory. If we have a quick look at the constructors, we'll look at Ferrari's recent scores. 38, 29, 32, like a couple of 50s, great. 47, 41, like 35. It's just, for the price you're paying, you're getting like only just a little bit over 1 point per million, effectively, particularly in the last three races. And you compare it to the Red Bulls in the last few races, 77, 69, 72, like they're getting like upwards towards 2 points per million. Even though they cost nearly 40 million, they're still producing great value. So I'm quite happy to have keep the Red Bulls just in there. So yeah, the Ferraris just haven't been exciting. And so that's why for me, I'm thinking that I might just ditch off Leclerc and go with Hamilton, just for that kind of safe aspect. And then Carlos Sainz, there's a strong rumour that Carlos Sainz is going to be having a grid penalty for taking some sort of, I don't know if it's like a completely new engine or what components, etc. But there's lots of rumours on Twitter going around that he is going to be taking a grid penalty, which is obviously going to hamper him, but he's still probably the best turbo driver. Because we've got the sprint race, and the sprint race is kind of a get-out-of-jail-free card, so anyone starting towards the back in a fast car has the opportunity to just sail forward in the sprint race and get into a good position for the Grand Prix. So I think Sainz should still score pretty well as a turbo driver. The alternative would be like Lando Norris, particularly if you're on a bit more of a budget. I think Lando Norris could be a great option. He's on that quali streak as well. See the little blue flame there. And Lando Norris is very consistent. If we go back to this green column, which I'm going to bang on about, endlessly, we've seen Lando Norris here with just four points gained from positions gained or lost. Now you might think, well, that's nothing compared to like Mercedes and Aston Martins that I've been talking about, but that tells a different story for me. The way I interpret that is that Lando Norris, he qualifies wherever he qualifies, he kind of finishes the race there. He doesn't really drop back, he doesn't excel forward, because he probably, you know, he qualifies quite high relative to the midfield, and therefore he's not really going to overtake the Ferraris and the Red Bulls, etc. But he will kind of maintain his position. That gives me, you know, that confidence that he's a safe, consistent driver. And that is kind of represented in the same sort of score. We see Perez here with 5 and Verstappen with 6 points. So again, not like masses of points, but it tells me that kind of where they qualify is kind of where they finish. And that's obvious with Max Verstappen. He pretty much puts it on pole and then finishes first, so which is why he's gained very few points from that. But they also, it also tells me reliability-wise that they're pretty safe. They're not dropping back too much. They're not getting the DNFs like the Ferraris here. So Lando Norris certainly could be an alternative to Carlos Sainz if you're not happy with Carlos Sainz, particularly if he's got a heavy grid penalty that's going to shove him towards the back. I mean, it could be open for Lando Norris to come in there on his little quali streaks, a nice little bonus there, which he should be getting. It's not a guarantee they'll get in the top 10 and get that streak, but, you know, he should be getting, I think. So yeah, you could definitely see myself going with a team like this if Ferrari just looked completely off it or whatnot. But I personally am currently leaning towards Ferrari. But obviously, we're going to see what happens in FP1. And if it's, you know, if Ferrari's looking like they're really back on it, then I'll go with it. If they look like they're really struggling for FP1, then I may consider Lando Norris. Because, again, same sort of reasons as Lewis Hamilton, just makes me feel safe. I need that safety and security. I need a nice stress-free Grand Prix weekend, please. Yeah, so what do you think? What do you think about that? Do you think you're going to go kind of heavy on Verstappen? Do you kind of ignore Verstappen? Are you going to be mega driving Verstappen? Have you been that patient and holding out? You know, I almost didn't mega drive Verstappen in Japan, but I went with it despite the rain danger, and it just about paid off. You know, there's a few scares in that race with the wet conditions, but it paid off for me back then. And if we look at what's happened in recent, where are we? Imola. This was the first sprint race of the season. Max Verstappen scored 62 points. Very nice if you mega drive him. And another factor to bear in mind is, because it's a sprint race, I think having this kind of all-round team that looks like this, you know, all these guys, maybe the exception of Vettel, should be finishing in the top 7 or 8, roughly. I mean, as long as he doesn't DNF again with his reliability issues. If you look at the top 7 or 8 positions, you see how well they score. They're all like sort of 25, 30 and above, and that's pretty good. That's what you want to be hitting. And if we go across to the next sprint race along in Austria, it's a similar sort of story. The top sort of 7 or 8 are scoring, you know, 20, 30 plus. I think having that kind of all-round team, not necessarily just going all in for Verstappen. However, as we've seen, you know, the people that win the sprint and the Grand Prix, they come away with like 60, 50 points, which is enough. You know, that's equivalent to like one of these drivers down here. Two of these drivers down here. I don't even know what I'm saying anymore. So, you know, for example, Charles Leclerc won the last sprint race, and that's worth two Lando Norrises and a tiny bit extra from down there in seventh position. So it kind of depends. How do you want to play it? Do you want to kind of go all in on Max Verstappen? Do you want to try and cover him off, or do you want to just kind of ignore him, having that nice all-round team that hopefully all sort of collectively pick up some nice points? That's where I'm at the moment. I'm kind of leaning towards a team like this, but that philosophy might change. Obviously, we've still got a few days as of the time of recording this before the deadline comes up. We've obviously got FP1, so there's going to be more news coming up. There'll be more updates about who's taking grid penalties, if there are any. So we're going to collate all that information and hopefully have all that in our heads come the deadline stream on Friday, which I'm very much looking forward to, because I've done a couple of them so far this season. They've been great fun. Really fun to interact with you guys, because, you know, at the end of the day, I'm basically just talking into my laptop, and it's very lonely. So I like talking to you guys. So yeah, come join me for the deadline. I'm looking forward to it. And yeah, then there's just one race to go in Abu Dhabi. And that'll be the season done. So yeah, tell me, guys, what are you thinking? What sort of philosophy are you thinking? Are you going to go for it? Are you going to be a bit safe, which is kind of what I'm edging towards? What's your goal for the season? Are you going to be looking for the global rank? Are you looking just for the mini leagues? Have you got money on the line? You know, what's going on in your F1 fantasy world? Just F1 fantasy world. I don't know what's going on in your fantasy world. That's just like, let's not go there. But yeah, F1 fantasy, tell me all about it. And yeah, that's it for me until the deadline. I'll hopefully see you there. Thanks very much for watching, and have a good week. Bye-bye.